your hymnal, let's go and turn to page 1, and we'll sing the first, the second, and the last of Joyful, Joyful We Adore Thee. Go ahead and stand as we sing. We'll sing the first 3 verses of the church's One Foundation. Modern and ancient, go ahead and turn to page 14 and we'll sing all 3 verses of Before the Throne of God Above. You can remain seated as we sing.
Tells me of my guilt within.
111 in your hymns, Modern Ancient. And we'll sing Still My Soul Be Still. Go ahead and stand. And as we sing the first verse, the children are dismissed to children's church.
Before I get started and go any further, I know the Alianos are back today, and we are thankful for that. God bless them with a beautiful little girl, Olive, and she is 2 weeks, 3 weeks? 2 weeks, just 2 weeks. All right. So Mike and Kim and the crew are back today, and very thankful for that blessing to them and that precious gift of a new child. Well, thinking about children, most folks don't like to hear negatives. I think that's probably fair to say. But sometimes hearing a proper negative warning can keep us from great harm or keep us from wasting our lives in frustrating and foolish ways. Think back to caring for little children. Our children need a fair share of no, don't touch that. No, don't do that. Now, is that because we're trying to stifle them? Is that because we want to hamstring them from their future potential and development? No, we realize there's a lot of dangerous things in life. And we want to protect them. We want to nurture them. We don't want them to go in a way that would be dangerous and counterproductive. And so we tell them, no, don't do that. Don't go that way. And then we add, here's what you should do. And we help the child, that will hurt you, that will harm you, that's not in your best interest, but this is good. This will bring blessing, this will bring opportunity. Don't go that way, go this way. And we spend a lifetime helping our children as they're growing and maturing, know what's dangerous, know what's unprofitable, and helping them to know the things that will bless and enrich their lives. Now, I don't think that I enjoyed hearing no, even as a little child, just a year or two old. You know, you can see those little kids, somebody gonna make me? I don't wanna do that. And you know, that goes against our stubborn little will. But the fact is, our Heavenly Father who loves us cares enough about our protection and our nurturing and our development that he gives us both no's and yeses. And this passage that we're going to look at this morning is actually structured just like that. In fact, the first half of the passage is a no. And the second half of the passage is a yes. And they fit together to help us understand what the Christian life is supposed to be like. So what I'd like us to do this morning is to look at Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. And we're going to look this morning beginning in verse 17. And we'll work through as far as we have time and opportunity through that paragraph. The first 16 verses of that chapter we've looked at over a number of weeks talk about the unity of the body of Christ, the unity of God's people and the local church. We've been made one in Christ. We have one Lord, one Savior, but we have many different gifts. We're diverse and yet unified. We looked at the fact that God gives people different gifts, including people who would hold different offices so that they can function to minister, to strengthen the people in the body of Christ. So the body of Christ can be edified and do its job, so we're all growing together so that the work of the ministry is accomplished and the church is made stronger. But as we move into this next section, verse 17 and following, it's a reminder about how we are to walk in this world as individuals because we're a part of the body of Christ, because we have been born again. It makes a difference how we should and can walk. And again, it begins with a no, and it continues with a yes. I want you to just look so you can see that. It's not a complex outline. But look at verse 17 through 19. You can see the word not right in the middle of verse 17. Walk not as other Gentiles. All right, he's writing specifically writing to these Ephesian believers who were saved out of pagan backgrounds and lifestyles. They had not been brought up with the scriptures and the God Jehovah. They had not been brought up with a belief in the true and living God. And yet they heard about Jesus Christ. They heard the good news of the gospel. They heard of his mercy and grace. And they came to faith. Even though they came out of a pagan background, they were transformed. They were made new in Christ. And they had life everlasting. And he says, walk not as the other Gentiles. And he spends those three verses, 17 and 19, saying, this is how you used to walk. This is how they still walk. Don't walk in that path any longer. Look at verse 20 to 24. And you can look down through here. And it doesn't use the word do, but it talks about the fact you have not so learned Christ the way those Gentiles are walking. And it implies that this is the way, and it describes it, this is the way you are to walk. This is the way you are to live. So let's go back to verse 17. And if you're following along in the bulletin, there's an outline there on one of the back panels. You can fill in the blanks if that helps you, and you'll be able to follow along. But verse 17 through 19, I would summarize it this way for us. Christians need to look back with humble gratitude. Christians need to look back with humble gratitude. And we could sum it up this way. You aren't the same person you used to be, so don't live like you are. I mean, God has done a work to change us. I mean, it's going to talk about this is the way Gentiles think. This is the way the Gentiles desire and their passions. This is the way the Gentiles behave. Unsaved people, unbelievers, they're governed, they're controlled, they're saturated by these ways of thinking and feeling and behaving. Don't walk in that, because you're not the same person you used to be. You aren't the same person, so don't live like you are. I mean, the focus is really not on trying to shame the Gentiles. It's not on trying to embarrass unbelievers. They do what they do because that's what governs their thinking. That's what controls their passions. That's what energizes their behavior. It's saying, listen, we all know what it was like in our past life before we were redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, before we were saved by His grace and mercy. We remember what it was like. And because God has a holy purpose, a holy calling upon us, we can't live like that any longer. So what does the the unsaved mindset, how is it described here? I mean, we're reminded that we should not walk even as the Gentiles which know not God in 1 Thessalonians 4. And that we should not walk any longer like we used to walk, like unbelievers all around us still walk, because we are in the Lord. And the reason we can't live like we used to is because God has done a work in us, and no longer do we have minds controlled by sin. I mean, the description of the unsaved person who has rejected Christ is that sin has affected the mind deeply. Because of the fall has affected the mind of people. I mean, there are brilliant people, gifted people, but even people with IQs of 140, 150, 160 or higher, their minds are still infected by the fall, by the curse of sin. That the way our minds are bent to thinking, because of the influence of sin in the human race, that even with all the brilliance and intellect a person might muster, their thinking is still skewed by sin. We could put it another way. Unbelievers have a spiritually, intellectually unproductive mind, that there's a futility of sorts in unbelievers. It speaks of in the vanity of their minds having the understanding darkened, verse 17. And that's where we used to live. That's where we used to live. The vanity of the mind having the understanding darkened. I mean, the thinking that leads to no substantial purpose, thinking that is void of useful aim or goal. It's described by one person as a good-for-nothing way of thinking spiritually. In terms of responding and answering to a holy Creator God, the mind of the unsaved person has been affected by sin so that it is intellectually unproductive, it is futile, it is vain, it is good for nothing in terms of spirituality, in terms of eternity. All of that leads to the underlying irresponsible behavior that comes from it. And since the unbeliever does not know God, he cannot truly understand the world around him, neither can he properly understand himself. You might have heard of a well-known American poet from a century or more ago. His name was Henry David Thoreau. He said, "Our world today possesses a great deal of knowledge, but very little wisdom. We have improved means to unimproved ends." And you know, sin still causes the same problems in life that it's caused for millennia. Even though we have all sorts of wonderful gadgets, even though we've learned infinitely more about the minutiae of our universe and how it works, but there is still the futility and the vanity of the mind, and it results in understanding being darkened. We know that Satan has blinded the minds of the unsaved because he does not want them to see the truth of Jesus Christ. And it's not simply that their eyes are blinded so that they cannot see, but that the minds are darkened so they cannot think straight about spiritual matters. I mean, that's why people who don't know Jesus Christ, have not been saved by mercy and grace, are always trying to figure out a way to prove that they're good enough to demonstrate their worth, to earn their way into the presence of God. And there's a futility of thinking that robs people of a clarity that's needed. When it comes to spiritual and moral issues, the thinking of unbelievers is distorted and inadequate, failing to produce godly understanding or moral living. The reality is that Christians think differently from unsaved people. It doesn't mean that every thought we think is right or that every thought that we ever contemplate is perfect, but it means that the mind has been regenerated by the work of God in our lives so that we think about life and eternity from God's perspective instead of from an earthbound, time-bound perspective. Throughout this passage, it talks about mind and understanding or ignorance and learning Christ. And sin has affected the mind, and we can't walk that way anymore. We can't let our thinking be controlled by sinful patterns. We need to allow our regenerated mind to stay focused on scriptural patterns, on spirit-endowed patterns, on Christ-like patterns of thinking that are productive and enlightened in terms of eternity and spiritual things. Notice also in verse 18, sin has affected the heart. The heart is the control center of life, and it refers to the deep-seated affections and desires that drive a person's life. It says here in verse 18, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart. Unbelievers are separated from the life that comes from God because of the ignorance and blindness that controls them. They are ignorant and insensitive to God and his ways. I mean, it's certainly true that the average unsaved person today has quick and easy access to more information than at any other point in all of human history. Yet it has not changed the human heart. It may have brought about all sorts of devices and processes that save money and time, or make possible great advances in medicine or transportation or all sorts of other areas of life. But unbelievers are still left with a gaping disconnect from God's truth and spiritual life. And it says, we can't walk like that anymore. If we have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, if we have been saved by the grace and mercy of God, then we can't allow those passions and desires that characterized our life in days gone by, that still characterize in general people all around us, we can't allow those passions and those desires to influence our decision making. We have been saved by Christ, and we cannot walk that way anymore. Not only has sin affected the mind or the thinking, it's affected the heart, the passions and desires, but this passage reminds us that sin has affected moral behavior. I mean, you can see two things there in verse 19. It says, who being past feeling have given themselves over unto lasciviousness to work all uncleanness and greediness. Who being past feeling, and that is that the unsaved person, apart from a relationship with God, is morally insensitive. That doesn't mean that every unsaved person does every wicked or bad thing they could. It doesn't mean that every bad thing they do it as badly as some people do. I mean, total depravity doesn't mean that everybody goes to the extent of a Adolf Hitler. But it means that every unsaved person has capabilities within them that we as sinners saved by grace are reminded that we had those capabilities within us that would shock us, given the right provocation, the right circumstances. But the heart of an unbelieving person has become morally insensitive. Some show it to greater degrees. Some have more common grace restraint. But because of a lack of sensitivity, unbelievers give themselves over or abandon themselves to sensuality or lasciviousness, living a life without concern for personal standards or social sanctions. They simply don't give a rip. Unbelievers continue to sin and turn away from God. They become increasingly apathetic about moral and spiritual things. And again, not every person will show that to the same degree, but just look at the cultural degeneration. Look at what's going on in our culture around us. And increasingly, you hear examples of people who take the life of another person. Why did you do it? Because I felt like it. They had it coming to them. For what? For what? I mean, you see how morally people can become insensitive, desensitized to obligations as human beings, to obligations as citizens. And they're past feeling and have abandoned themselves, turned themselves over to fulfillment of all manner of desires. They continue to turn away from God and become increasingly apathetic. Their consciences become so atrophied that they no longer respond properly to moral confrontation over sinful issues. I mean, we see more and more the breakdown of, weren't you ever taught? I mean, I am thankful that because of God's common grace, not every person who does not know Jesus Christ, not every person who's not saved, they don't do everything they could. I mean, there is a sense in which there is moral restraint taught by parents, taught by society. And I'm thankful for the benefit of those things, or we would be in far greater difficulty than we are. But you can see all around you people who have become morally insensitive and do things whatever they contemplate, whatever they feel like, whatever they envision. And sin has affected moral behavior in that there's morally depraved influence going on. It says, they have given themselves over unto lasciviousness or sensuality to work all uncleanness, every sort of wicked, unimaginable thing, and with greediness, that is, with a selfish domination that it doesn't matter how it affects you, I just want what I want. I mean, we're surrounded by that. I mean, you may not run into it often, but I know when I worked with police officers as a police chaplain, they would remind me periodically that they regularly work with the dregs of society. They regularly are forced to interact, to intervene between civilized society and those who have abandoned all sense of propriety, and they regularly have to interact and intervene with those who don't care how it affects others, who only care about what's in it for me. And they pursue all manner of sinful expression without thought to the costs to others. They continually give themselves over to unrestrained sensuality, increasingly loose moral restraint, especially in the area of sexual sins. And we're seeing that all around us in our culture, aren't we? And it's possible even to be fooled into thinking, so many people do that, it can't be that wrong. But folks, just because people are told they have a right to murder the child within them doesn't make it morally right. Just because they're given political, legal sanction and protection, just because people more and more will abandon marriage and live intimately together outside of the bonds of marriage doesn't make it right. Just because people will practice all sorts of sensual expression just because it's possible doesn't mean that it's right. But we see that going on all around us as our society in many respects just sinks deeper and deeper into debauchery. I mean, it's not some of these things I wouldn't even speak of in a public assembly, but you've read about them, you've heard about them, you know the kind of things that go on in our society that are grievous. And moral abandonment leads to all kinds of immoral practices that become all-absorbing and preoccupying for people. And the result is that people can come to the point where they only exist to satisfy their basest desires. Now, as in our day, increasingly, back in the day when the scriptures, the New Testament was written, when these people received this, they lived in a Roman culture. These people that first received the letter of Ephesians lived in what's now modern-day Turkey. It was called Asia Minor, a province of the Roman Empire. And they were surrounded by wickedness of every imaginable sort. And there was incredible pressure. There was financial pressure. There was social pressure. There was religious pressure. There was governmental pressure on them to go with the flow, live like those around you. Don't rock the boat. Don't cause waves. Don't make people look bad. Don't go against the system. And yet they had a choice to make. They said, God has redeemed me by the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ. I've been saved by his grace and mercy. He has made me his child. I am a part of his church. I have been called out for holy purposes. I don't live for that any longer. I can't let that kind of thinking influence my thinking. I can't let those kind of passions and desires influence my desires. I can't allow that kind of behavior to influence my behavior. I need to do that which is pleasing to the Lord. He says, I therefore testify in the Lord that you henceforth, from this point on, because you are believers, walk not as other Gentiles walk. Don't allow those things to influence and shape the way you think and your passions and desires and your activities. Paul knew the value of a good, strong no. And whenever we are tempted to say, well, you know, it can't be that bad, it can't be that terrible, because look at some of the nice people who are my friends or neighbors or coworkers. Look at how they think. Look at what they desire. Look at how they behave. But folks, we're not the same people we used to be, and we can't live like we are. We have to live like we have been transformed. We've been called out of the world, called into the church, that we have been regenerated. We've been transformed and made to be children of God. And we can't allow the world, as it says in Romans chapter 12, it says, be not conformed, squeezed into the mold of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And we need to continue to allow the reality that we belong to the Lord, so that we don't have thinking or desires and passions or behaviors that are displeasing to the Lord. The Christian cannot pattern himself after the unsaved person, because the Christian has experienced a miracle of being raised from the dead. His life is not futile but purposeful. His mind is filled with the light of God's word, and his heart is filled with fullness of God's life. He gives his body to God as an instrument of righteousness and not to sin for the satisfaction of his own selfish lusts. In every way, the believer is different from the unbeliever, and therefore the admonition, walk not. A quotation from Warren Wiersbe. You know, we not only have in this passage a walk not, but an implied do walk in this way. In verses 20 to 24. If verses 17 and 19 were an admonition, he says, I want to remind you, I want to challenge you. You got to take this serious. Remember all that God has done for you. You're not in that position anymore. You're not in that place anymore. So you can't live like that. But spiritually speaking, it is important for believers to also remember not just what's behind us, but that we're also focused on what is before us. I mean, have you ever noticed your automobile? It not only has three mirrors. I mean, you got the rear view mirror, and you got those two side mirrors, but you also have a great big windshield so that you're looking out in front of you and focused on what's in front. And we not only need to remember what we've been saved from so that we can not walk that way anymore, not live and be controlled by that kind of lifestyle anymore, but we also need to look forward. And that second main idea for this morning is that Christians need to look forward with humble determination. We need to look backward with humble gratitude that God saved us from that. But we need to look forward with humble determination. We're looking forward, and I just summarize it this way. You are someone new that you never used to be. So live like it. You're somebody new. God has done something new and unique and transforming, empowering in you. So we need to live like that. This is the yes. What all has God done in us? I mean, he shares an argument, an explanation with them. He gives them a careful description of how the Christian life is to operate. And it's a reminder, like 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, he that saith he abideth in him also ought so to walk, even as he walked, even as Christ walked. If we say that we know Jesus Christ, if we say that we abide in him, then we ought to walk like he walked. That there ought to be a profound transformed difference in our lives. And there's really two things in this passage. We'll look at them quickly, but look at verse 20 and 21. Really, it asks the question, why are you a new person? Or how are you described as being a new person? I mean, there's some figurative descriptions given about what it means to be a believer in Jesus Christ. Now, when we talk about that, we tend to say, I'm saved, I'm a Christian, I have believed. And those are all great terms. Those are all great concepts. But it doesn't use any of those in this verse. And yet it still talks about the transformation of the new birth, the new life. Look at what it says in verse 20 and 21. But you have not so learned Christ. Now, at first glance, we might not catch everything that's there. But if you've heard the word disciple, the word disciple is right in that phrase. You could say it this way. You have not learned to be a disciple of Christ in this way. This is not what it means to be a follower, a devoted follower, a child of God. This is not the way you've learned to follow and learn from Jesus, like a disciple. I mean, the reality is that these new believers came to know Christ. They had learned Christ. They had become disciples or devoted followers. They'd been called by Jesus, and the Spirit had worked through the truth to call them to follow him. They'd learned Christ. They had a personal relationship with him. They were his disciples. They had learned Christ. They'd become followers, devoted adherents of Jesus Christ. It also says, if so be that you have heard him. Now, it is certain, almost certain, It's possible, because most of these people were Gentiles. It's possible some of them could have been proselytes and been in Jerusalem and had met Jesus. But in large measure, it's not talking about that they heard Jesus speak audibly. Even that theoretically would be possible that someone there might have heard his voice. But it says that you heard Christ. Believers heard of Christ. In the preaching of the word, Christ himself is present, and these people were exposed to the word of Christ through the declared word of God. I mean, it's a reminder that the better we understand the word, the better we know the Son of God. I mean, the whole Bible is a revelation about God, and in particular the Messiah, Jesus Christ. And these folks had heard Christ. They had heard the declaration that he is God, man, that he is the Messiah come from heaven to earth who lived and died for us. They had heard of Christ and they had believed on the claims of who he was. They had been taught by him. Not taught by him as sitting at his feet physically, but they, nonetheless, it was true that these believers, like it is for us now, that they had been taught by means of Christ, or taught by virtue of their relationship in Christ. And we have been taught the truth of Christ and accepted him. I mean, Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by him. And these people had heard the truth in Jesus. They had believed upon him and been born again. But I want us to look especially at verse 22 to 24, because what exactly has happened in making us new persons? What has happened in making us new creatures in Christ? I mean, we know that God has worked so that we've become followers. We've learned to become disciples of His. We have heard Him and believed. We have been taught by Him through the truth of the Word and believed. We've received the truth which is in Jesus. We see the truth embodied and illustrated, a living object lesson of truth in the person of Christ. But what exactly has happened in making us new persons? I mean, what really is so powerful and transformative that we're not the same people we used to be? We're someone new that we've never ever been before through the power of regeneration. Look at verse 22 to 24. In our English translation, this can be a little bit tough to decipher. Okay, it's not sneaky, mysterious, but let me illustrate. The word put, all right? You see, look at verse 22. Put off, and verse 24, put on. The awkward thing is, in our English language, the verb put, with the same exact spelling, in English, we use it for a present tense command. Put that away for me. Please. Put that away. That's a present command. But if I was to say, you put that away yesterday, it's a statement of past fact. It's not a command. It's a statement of what's been completed. And so we use that English word with the same tense. And so looking back, looking through, let me just try to explain very simply and straightforward. I believe that these verses, when it talks about put off and put on, it is not a commandment that we must do. It is a reminder of a reality that God has done for us. I mean, the old man is the old life dominated, controlled by sin. We don't put off the old man. God did that by making us a new man. God did that by the power of the work of the Spirit through His truth, through His Word. It's talking about something that is a settled reality for the believer in Jesus Christ. That you put off the old man. That old man, the old way of life was put away from you. We have died in Christ, been raised again to walk in newness of life in Christ Jesus. And just like we have put off the old man, it's not our responsibility to somehow summon up the strength to put off the old man on our own. That old person was put to death by the power of God when we trusted in Christ. In the same way, it says, put on the new man. It's not saying that's a command. You've got to make yourself like a holy person, your own power and your own strength. You've got to make yourself, pull yourself up by the bootstraps and turn over a new leaf and make yourself a totally new person. God did that by His transforming power through the Spirit. That's a settled reality. Now, we still have the residual effects of the flesh. We're still capable of doing wrong. We sin. But the old man, that is the man, the person whose life was dominated by sinful thinking, by sinful passions and desires, by sinful behavior, that man has been put to death in Christ. And the new man who has new thinking and new passions and desires and a new desire to behave and live in a way pleasing to the Lord, that man has been created in Christ Jesus by the power of the Spirit through His Word. Those past tense spiritual realities. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. He is a new creation. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things are become new. I mean, that's the reality. If we are regenerated, we're transformed, I believe on Jesus Christ, He forgives me of my sin. He puts a new desire, regeneration, that He puts a new governing disposition in my heart. He makes me somebody I wasn't before. I'm not the same person that I used to be. But there is, within this passage, also a present responsibility, and I want you to see that. He's created us so that we've put on the new man, created in Christ Jesus, to live in righteousness, that is, fulfill our moral responsibilities to other human beings, to live right before God in relationships, and to live properly in holiness, that is to acknowledge our spiritual responsibilities to God. But the present tense obligation, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that actually is a present tense. That's kind of an interesting thing. I won't bore you with this, but it's a present tense passive. So if you were to say it a little more literally, it would be something like this, that we should be allowing ourselves to be renewed in the inner man, in the spirit of the mind. We should be allowing ourselves to be renewed. In other words, I don't and pump up and I'm feeling renewed. I did it. But we yield ourselves in willing obedience. We yield ourselves in glad submission to the Lord and the truth of His word and the power of the Spirit, so we can be strengthened with might in the inner man by His Spirit. And folks, that is a reality that we should give ourselves to constantly. That conversion is a crisis that leads to a process. We were born again. We were regenerated. We didn't turn over a new leaf little by little. We were transformed and regenerated by an act of God. And that crisis, that conversion experience, unleashes a lifelong process of seeking to be renewed in the spirit of our mind by the Lord through His word. Through Christ, once and for all, we've been given a new position in Him. We're new creatures in Christ, but day by day, we must, by faith, appropriate, personally apply, and put into practice all that He has given for us in terms of truth. The word of God renews the mind as we surrender our all to Him. I mean, listen to John 17:17. This was Jesus' prayer for His disciples, and He said, sanctify them through thy truth. That is, set them apart for holy purposes. Keep shaping and making them more like you. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. As the mind understands the truth of God's word, it is gradually transformed by the Spirit, and this renewal leads to a changed life. I mean, physically, it's said that you are what you eat. You know, eat better, take fewer trips to the doctor, you know. But spiritually, we are what we think. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. And instead of being subject to all sorts of progressive deterioration, is the sinful old man with his wrong thinking and wrong passions and desires and his wrong behaviors just cycles down and down towards more degenerate, more destructive behavior. The believer has been transformed in Jesus Christ, is allowing the Spirit to renew his mind so that he's continuing to grow and to mature and to become more like Jesus Christ, which is God's ultimate promise and our ultimate expectation, that one day we will be conformed to his image. Folks, Paul wanted to encourage these believers. God wants through this scripture to really encourage us. He is going to talk, beginning in verse 25, about all sorts of practical things, about whether you speak the truth or whether you lie, whether you get angry or whether you hold your wrath in place, whether you steal or whether you choose to give sacrificially and lovingly to help others, whether you speak with words that are corrupt and foul, or whether you speak words that are pure and edifying and gracious to help others. He's going to talk about the kind of attitudes we harbor in our heart, whether we keep a place for bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking and malice, or whether we will allow God to work in our hearts so that we are kind and tender-hearted and forgiving each other. The one is not God's will. The other is. And we need to let God continue to work in us to keep us growing and maturing to be more like Christ. But for those things to happen, we've got to be like the little kid. If we're going to really grow, if we're going to be productive, if we're going to be safe, we've got to listen to the walk not in this way. That's who you used to be, and you're not that same person anymore, so you can't live like it. But now you are somebody new, somebody that you never were before. So live like God purposed and planned for you. I mean, if we really understand who we're not anymore, if we really understand who we are in Christ now, it will shape the way that we respond when we hear the thinking of the world. It will shape the way we respond when we see the desires and the passions of the world all around us on display. It will change us when we're tempted to act and express behaviors like we see that dominate the lives of people in the world. And we'll say, that's not who I am anymore. I belong to Christ. I can't walk that way anymore. I am, the old man is dead, the new man has been given life, and now as a child of God, I need to keep allowing him to renew my spirit so that I'm growing to be more like him. That's the life he wants me to walk. And folks, every day of our Christian life and experience, we will face that choice, that decision, many times over. You'll read an article in the newspaper. You'll see something in a magazine. You'll hear something on television. You'll be exposed to something in a conversation in the workplace or in the neighborhood. And you'll have decisions to make. Am I going to be conformed to the world? Or am I going to be transformed, renewed in the spirit, by the renewing of my mind? And folks, God has grand and glorious things in mind for us. But we are still sinners saved by grace. And we are capable of doing some things that just aren't consistent at all. They fit with the old life. They don't fit with the new. And if we really understand all that God wants to do for us, all the yeses that he has planned for us, we will give ourselves over to him because the old man's been defeated, the new man's been given life, and he wants to renew our spirit to become more like him. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I know that some passages of Scripture are more practical in application. They talk about the how to do this and the why to do this and what are my options. But Lord, if we don't truly grasp and embrace the reality of who we were and that way just does not fit for us to walk in those paths any longer, no matter how tempting or appealing it may be in this world. And if we don't understand all that God has done to make possible for us victory in Christ, and that we need to continually yield ourselves to him for the renewing of our mind, the transforming, the shaping of our spirit, Lord, then we will not see all that you desire for us. But Father, if we will trust you, we will obey you, we will follow you, we will heed what we've learned, we will heed what we've been taught, we will follow what we have seen. And Lord, you have such grand and glorious things that you want to produce in our lives for your glory, for our good, for the benefit of all around us. Lord, help us to remember we're somebody new, we've never been before. And that you want to see us to walk in new paths for new blessing and new glory. And Father, I thank you for that. Lord, if there's one here today who does not know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, it is your stated desire that in response to the gospel, that if they believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ, they shall be saved. That they can be born again, that they can be regenerated, they can be transformed, given freedom from the penalty of sin, be given freedom from the penalty of sin and the power of sin, that they can live a life pleasing to you. So Father, I pray that you'd really help us to think, to desire, to behave in ways that truly reflect all the incredible things you've done in us for your honor and glory. And I do thank you for that. I pray, Father, you'd just challenge our hearts. Keep this ever before us that we might be pleasing to you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.